and everything?
Yeah, everything's perfect.
Good morning, everyone. How are we doing on this beautiful frosty day? Isn't this great, right? I like this. Yeah, for a lot of us that live in Southwest Florida now, we forget what socks feel like this time of year. So, well, welcome. This is our annual storm spotter training. We have representatives from the National Weather Service here have come down from Tampa area to be with us to give us a very, very valuable training for us. My name is Dr. Jesse Spiro. I am the Division Manager of Emergency Management for the Cape Coral Fire Department's Division of Emergency Management. We've got a great crowd here today. Thank you for braving the weather. So, couple of things here. Just want to let you know that this is a training class that we asked the National Weather Service to come down to provide for us, for our community members, every year, if not every other year for us. Oftentimes, it's difficult for them to get away. They have a very large region that they cover. They have a lot of partners that they work with. So having it here in our community is a very, very good value to you, to the community. So we're going to be recording this today and then streaming it for future. So if you have friends and neighbors and family that miss this but wanted to attend it or would like more information, we can share that with that. And you can tell them they can go to our Cape TV website and they can view the information from there as well. So one of the benefits about living in Southwest Florida is we have great weather, we have beautiful beaches, we have lots of recreation, but part of living in paradise and part of being exposed to a very recreation and outdoor-oriented lifestyle is you have to be aware of the weather and the changing conditions with weather. So with that, if you're able to identify the formation of severe weather before it becomes a major issue for you and your family and your community, it really can help you take the necessary measures to protect your home, your family, and your loved ones. So this is just one of the many trainings that are offered out there, and this is an in-class training we're able to provide through the National Weather Service for this. And if you are interested in more information on this, we'll be providing it for you, and a part of that is becoming members of our CERT program, our Community Emergency Response Team. How many members here are part of our Cape Coral CERT program? Excellent. Very, very good. Lots of people here. If you are interested in learning more about the Community Emergency Response Team and some of the classes and the activities that we perform, you can see myself or Miss Misha Jackson in the back. She is here with me today to go over some of the benefits and how we can get you trained up year-round. So without any further ado, I'd like to introduce our good friend and partner through the National Weather Service, Mr. Dan Noah. Thank you, Dan.
Thank you, Justin. Good morning, everybody. A little administrative items. If you have to get up for any reason, please do so. I won't be offended. If you have to use the restroom, it's across the bridge and then to the right. If you want a Skywarn Spotter ID from me, you have to leave this sheet on the front table before you go. If you can't remember your ID number, just say I can't remember and I'll look you up. And if you don't have one, you'll get an email from me next week with your new Skywarn Spotter ID. And then you can take it and write it on this little black card that it has our 800 number on it. And if you see some of the things that we talk about today, you call this number, let us know what's going on in your neighborhood. And on the back is the things we want you to report. We mentioned some websites in this presentation. You don't have to hurry up to try to scribble them down. They're all listed on this page. This is a static sticker for your car. It says Skywarn. Sometimes you might be parked along the side of the road looking at maybe a water spout coming on shore, and law enforcement might say, hey, what are you doing? And you can say, oh, I'm a Skywarn spotter. They may or may not ask you to leave. If they ask you to leave, please do so. So let's go ahead and get started with the Skywarn training. If you look at this image, it's actually rotating. This is a supercell thunderstorm. It's a rotating thunderstorm updraft that's probably 15, 20 miles in diameter. That's what the radar is detecting for rotation. Oftentimes, we do not detect the tornado directly because a tornado, especially here in Florida, they're a quarter mile wide or less. Our radar beam, when it comes into Cape Coral, is about 5,000 feet off the ground. We can't see anything below 5,000 feet. And it's about three quarters of a mile wide. So it's very tough to see smaller tornadoes here. And that's what we mostly get. Let's see. All right, the mission of the National Weather Service is to provide weather, water, and climate data forecasts and warnings for the protection of life and property. That is our primary mission. We are under the Department of Commerce, of all things, so we're really hard to find in the phone book, because most people don't think to look there. And then there's the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, or NOAA. My last name is NOAA, and I used to be the only NOAA in NOAA, but now there's three of us with the last name of NOAA, so. So there's NOAA Fisheries, NOAA Ocean Service. We're the NOAA Weather Service. Under the Weather Service, we have these national centers like the Hurricane Center, Storm Prediction Center, River Forecast Center. They paint the big picture of what's going to happen in Cape Coral. It's my office up in Ruskin on exit 240 that paints all the small-scale details. And we communicate those details to emergency management, especially during tropical events, so they can know when to open up the shelters, pretty much to keep people safe in this community. So there's 122 local offices across the country. My last office was Bismarck, North Dakota. That was 15 years ago. It got down to 46 below zero without the wind chill. And my wife said she was leaving and I could go with her, so we did. And now we have vowed never to live north of Interstate 4. So we're a small office. We only have 23 employees, 17 are meteorologists. The others are technicians. They're keeping the equipment working at the Punta Gorda Airport, Fort Myers Airport. We're open 24/7. We never close. And we work rotating shifts. So we're working evenings, midnights, days. So we do specialized forecasting for aviation. We launch weather balloons. That's where the forecast process starts, because that's what initializes the computer simulations. Of course, we have the 7-day forecast. We do fire weather forecasting. It's been big lately. We've had a couple of big fires that have burned down some homes, especially in Polk County, southeast of Lakeland. Our main bread and butter is the radars and warnings. And relatively new is decision support services. It used to be in the 90s, the Weather Service was a black box that information came out of. And we didn't really have a lot of relationships with emergency management or our customers or our partners, and that's no longer the case. In fact, we'll actually work side by side in the EOC, the Emergency Operations Center, sometimes for larger events. So we issue the warnings that you hear or see on television. It's not the TV meteorologist that's doing that. It actually comes from Ruskin. But we are unique in this country. We have what's called an integrated warning team, and it's involves emergency management. They prepare for, respond to, and recover from the weather event. And then it's the private sector. It's the TV meteorologists, the radio stations, newspapers, the smartphone app developers. They are the ones that we rely on to deliver that message. So you'll notice we do not have a smartphone app. The private sector does that, so we can focus on warnings. How many of you have a weather radio? So about 10 to 14% of people have a weather radio. It's a nice low-tech way to get the warning. During the Moore, Oklahoma tornado, the cell phone towers got overloaded or were damaged, and so the smartphones weren't working. The internet went down, and people were getting warning information only because they had a weather radio. So it's important to have multiple ways to receive that warning message in case one way fails. And it's not just for weather. If there's a train derailment and a chemical spill, Jesse's group can turn on this weather radio to say shelter in place. Now this is alertpolk.com, but on your sheet there's alertflorida.com, and you can sign up for alerts for any county in the state. If you have property up north, you can sign up for that county as well. And the neat thing is it's not just for weather, but it's about boil water notices, gas leaks, law enforcement notices. So alertflorida.com, it's on your sheet, on one of your handouts. It's a good source to, you know, get that multiple ways to get that information. And then a lot of your TV stations also have notification services as well. How many of you have gotten an Amber Alert? So that means your phone is newer than 2013 or newer, and this wireless emergency alert is an enhancement to the emergency alert system. And it's you have to opt out. This is a fire that was down at Indian Lake Estates, southeast of Lakeland, and that's the alert that went on everybody's cell phone in that area. So it doesn't matter where you go in the country, it'll work. So let's say you're driving up into Minneapolis, Minnesota, and you drive into a tornado warning. You're going to get that alert. It says, hey, you might want to turn around. And the way it works, this is a tornado warning we did for Fort Myers. All the cell phone towers in that little red box are going to send out an administrative notice at the same time. So it's not a text message. It's an administrative notice. So any cell phone listening to those towers, they get it all at the same time. So that means if you're at a local restaurant or you're at church, and all of a sudden everybody's phone starts making noise, something bad is happening. Then there's this app from FEMA, FEMA.gov/app. The neat thing is the green bar, let's say you're in California on the beach and all of a sudden you're in a tsunami warning. Well, what do I do? You click prepare, you click tsunami, it tells you exactly what to do. The second one is weather alerts. You can get weather alerts by zip code. The third one, disaster resources. Let's say there's a hurricane comes through, your home is damaged, and you want to know how to apply for disaster assistance. That will tell you how. And then finally, the last one, disaster reporter. Well, the cell phone towers are probably going to be down, but you take pictures of your damage, and it's on your phone, and when you get internet access again, it's going to upload all your photos to the FEMA cloud, and then you can share it with your insurance adjusters. So it's a pretty neat app. This is the basic Skywarn training. We do have an advanced training, and we have actually two options. This is one of them. It's called spotternetwork.org. It's sort of like Skywarn for your smartphones. And what it does is they give you a special ID number. You plug it into your smartphone app, and you can turn on who you want to be able to see your data. Oh, the weather service, I'll let them see my phone number in case they want to call me, and we can track you. And this site is a nonprofit group. It's made up of people from the Weather Service, storm chasers, academia, and TV meteorologists. Even if you don't want to use the smartphone app, it's fun to take the training because now we're getting into severe weather season in Oklahoma, and you can track all the spotters. You can actually see the road network. There's so many spotters in Oklahoma, and some of them have live TV, and you can be in the car with them as they're going down the road. So this is an example of a radar app, and that's my location there in Ruskin. So there's a lot of different smartphone apps out there now, more than there used to be. And we're up to, 268 people in West Central and Southwest Florida that have opted into this program. Most people are amazed to hear that Florida ranks number 10 for states with the most tornadoes. We average 52 tornadoes a year. If we did it, Texas is number one, but at 142, but they're three times larger in area than Florida. If we did it by 100 square miles, Florida would be number one most years. But for us, a lot of those are waterspouts that come on shore, and then they go away very quickly. The tornado that hit Minnesota Key just the other day, it only went on the ground for a tenth of a mile before it disrupted. So the good news is we get 52 tornadoes, but the good news is most of those are weak and short-lived. So this is where we've had tornadoes so far this year. 363 tornadoes, normal for the entire year is about 1,200. If we zoom into Florida, you can see the two tornadoes that we just had in Charlotte County. We've had 10 tornadoes, 11 large hail events, but look, we've had 133 damaging wind events. That's where the thunderstorm developed this giant water balloon aloft, threw it at the ground, and it damaged something. So if you have damage in your neighborhood, it's 10 times more likely it was a downburst wind rather than a tornadic wind. So this is what Florida tornadoes look like. This is Layton, Alabama, but look at it, it's the width of a house. And it's not just the side-to-side motion that's causing the damage. Look at the suction power that thing has. So you really have to be unlucky to get hit by a tornado in Florida. But it does happen. It just happened a couple of days ago to some people, and it will cause damage. So we are going to issue a tornado warning if radar strongly suggests it's there or if one of you report it. Now, with the Minnesota Key tornado and the one up north of Punta Gorda near Cleveland, we did not have a tornado warning out for those. The signature on radar just didn't look that strong. Now, the signature that we had for Sarasota, just south of Sarasota, that was a very strong signature, but that tornado did not corkscrew its way down to the ground and cause damage. So radar is a good tool, but it doesn't tell us exactly what's happening at the ground. And that's where we need your help to report and let us know what's going on in your community. So we're going to talk a little bit about why we need spotters. Safety. Most of the time, you're going to be experiencing downburst winds rather than tornadoes. But we will talk about supercell thunderstorms and tornadoes, and then we'll end it with hurricanes. How many of you are amateur radio operators? A couple of us in here. Be sure to go to our, if you go to the Skywarn page, you can click on the amateur radio link and make sure the frequencies are and the PL tones are correct. If not, let me know. But if you have a scanner, this is a good page to go to see what frequencies to listen to. Are any of you Coco Ross observers? This is a Colorado University initiative, and their goal is to get a rain gauge every square mile across the country. And this is the pamphlet, and it's a volunteer program. The thing is, you need to have a rain gauge that looks like the one over here. It has to have at least a 4-inch opening to be accurate. Anything smaller than that, it's not going to be accurate, especially in heavy rain. If it's just light rain, it's probably pretty good, but heavy rain, it won't be so accurate. Now, we don't sell these. We use all this data to do forecasting for this area. So if any of you are interested in just being a volunteer rain observer, sign up, and they'll sell you one of these for like $30 plus shipping and handling. And all of your reports are archived at the National Data Climatic Center. So it's not just used for short-term forecast and warnings, it's also used for climatology and long range. So it's sort of like being a citizen scientist. So we have over 1,800 volunteers in Florida, and you can go to this page without being a member, and you can just zoom in to your county and see how much rain your neighbors had. So you can say, Fort Myers Airport had a trace of rain, and I'm going, it rained like 4 inches in my neighborhood. You can find out exactly how much it rained. So the main reason I'm here today is I want you to call whenever you see any of these things, any size hail whatsoever. We live in a tropical environment in Florida. Not today, but winds are getting strong over 50 miles an hour. Of course, tornadoes and water spouts. And if it's raining hard enough to impede traffic, let us know. We can put out an urban flood advisory and try to keep people away from that area. Your reports add credibility to our warnings. We know that radar is not perfect, but if we can say a trained Skywarn spotter reported a tornado entering the beach and going over Pine Island headed toward Cape Coral, people are more likely to take cover. This is our radar. We have a 28-foot diameter dish, and so that little ball is 3 stories high. The entire structure is about 10 stories high, and the bigger the dish, the smaller the beam, and that's important. So here's our radar looking at a shower or thunderstorm across the bay in St. Petersburg. And you can see the 3D image of that thunderstorm. The top has been cut off. We only scan up to 19 degrees and then we start over again. So we can't see anything above our head. So when this line of storms were coming over my office, you can kind of looks like a stadium effect. We just can't see above our head. Every radar has that issue. So we actually use Melbourne's radar to put out warnings for Ruskin. And then when you get really far away from the radar with that thunderstorm off of Melbourne's coast, if I do a cross section of that thick white line, you can see that near the coast, the center of the beam is about 10,000 feet off the ground. As you go out a little further, it's 15,000 feet above the ground. So the Earth is curving away from the beam. So the farther you go, the higher that beam is. Now, the good news is most thunderstorms are 40 to 50,000 feet high, so we can see them. We just can't see the very bottom. So for us to see a waterspout coming on shore at Sanibel or Captiva is going to be very hard for us to do that with our radar. So you're going to call an 800 number. You're going to get an answering machine, and people can hear your voice while you're talking. We want you to use the TELL method, time, event, location, to let us know what you saw. So here's an example of a good report. Give your spotter ID number. That means to us, that means that you've been to this class. And say, at 4:05 p.m., I drove through golf ball size hail 5 miles north of Ruskin on Highway 41. Well, what if you don't know how far away you are from the city center? Just give us an intersection of two streets and we'll find you. Now, when we're using time, the time on the back wall looks like 19 after. That's actually pretty good. My watch says 22 after. We would rather you use the time on your cell phone than your watch or a wall clock, because 5 minutes in radar time is a big deal, and our radar is synced up with the atomic clock, and so are cell phones every so often. What to report? Of course, tornadoes, funnel clouds. We'll talk about wall clouds. You want it to be rapidly rotating. You don't want it just to be this lazy rotation. Or if it's getting to be evening, the sun is setting, you go, that looks like a funnel cloud, but it's not rotating, then it's probably just some funny looking cloud. So you see this rapid rotation aloft, but the visible funnel does not extend to the ground. We don't care about the visible funnel, we care about the rotation. So look underneath the funnel. If you see sea spray or dust being kicked up, then it is a tornado or water spout, even though the visible funnel does not extend to the ground. When reporting tornadoes, tell us where you are, then tell us where the tornado is. So in this case, I'm in Arcadia at the intersection of 70 and 31, and I see a tornado off to my northeast. A lot of times, we just get the report of where the spotter is, and we don't know which direction the tornado is. Estimating wind speed is really hard. You could have this handheld anemometer, but if rain is blowing horizontally at 45 miles an hour, you're not going to sit out there and hold it. So after the storm blows through, look outside and see, oh, there's a bunch of twigs and moss littering the roads. Winds are probably 45 miles an hour. Oh, there's several healthy branches from a tree the size of my wrist. Well, winds are getting closer to 60 miles an hour. When you're looking at tree damage, is it isolated or is it a bunch of trees? If it's isolated, look at the tree. Is the tree diseased or rotted? It might not have taken 60 mile an hour winds to knock that tree over. So let's say this is a new roof put on last month. It was installed correctly, and we see this damage. Now these shingles are rated to 120 miles an hour. How fast do you think the winds were? You would think they'd be pretty strong, but we estimated them to be only 80 miles an hour. So why are these shingles coming off at 80 miles an hour? It's because of the weight in the water in the wind. It's just not the wind. It's, you know, water's heavy. It weighs 8 pounds a gallon. So imagine throwing a gallon of water at the roof at 80 miles an hour. That's what's causing the damage. So the heavier the rain and the faster the winds, the more damage you'll get. This RV dealership near Plant City had $750,000 worth of damage. Very impressive. How fast do you think the winds were for this? We estimated 50 miles an hour. These are lightweight vehicles. They have a big flat side that catches the wind, and they just dominoed across the parking lot. Newly planted trees next to these weren't even blown over. They were just, the leaves were on them still. So sometimes you can have very impressive looking damage. Especially with older mobile homes that have a secondary roof or carport that can peel up the roof, it doesn't take 60 mile an hour winds to damage some of those. Now, when reporting like this, of course, this is severe wind. Tell us, you know, well, I got power lines and power poles down. Try to tell us a little bit more. Say, oh, I've got, looks like 8 power poles down. It helps us estimate the wind speed and how severe that storm is. So looking at tornado damage, you go, so, you know, the top roof there, that looks destroyed. But to us, we want to know how much of the roof is gone. So in this case, you'd say, oh, we have some roof damage, about 20% of the roof is gone. Versus the one on the bottom, 100% of the roof is gone. And then tell us something about the age of the home. Well, that home on the bottom looks like it was from the 50s, and maybe the building codes weren't quite as strong back then as they are today. So all of that helps us to estimate the wind speed. With flooding, you know, tell us if cars are being impeded in traffic. If water is getting into several homes or several businesses, we'll upgrade it probably to a flash flood warning versus a flood advisory. And then if people are walking around in this bacterial soup, let us know about that too, and we tell people not to do that. So water is heavy, and moving water has a lot of power. 6 inches of fast-moving water is enough to knock most people off their feet. 2 feet of moving water is enough to push most vehicles into the ditch where it can flip upside down and people can drown. So if there's ever water flowing across the road, we say turn around, don't drown. Looking at hail, this is a weird hailstone. Always measure the longest diameter. If there's a bunch of pea-sized hail in one hailstone that looks like that, you always tell us what the largest hailstone is. So this is 4.5-inch hail. If there's damage, windows are breaking, or vinyl siding is being shredded on the side of a house, if we put that in our statement, people are going to get out of that storm's way, or they're going to seek shelter in their home. So So the number one report of hail we get is marble-sized hail, but we ask that you don't report marble-sized hail because we don't know how big your marbles are. So relate it to the size of a coin, or just measure it after the storm has gone by. We don't put out warnings for lightning because all thunderstorms have lightning. If you can hear thunder, you're close enough to the storm to be struck by lightning and should seek shelter. But if there's a wildfire or a house burnt down and you read it the next day in the newspaper, let us know anyway because we might have missed it, and we try to document that. So this area gets about 90 days a year with thunderstorms. Tampa Bay gets a little bit more because the bay starts the storms earlier. Charlotte Harbor, actually, the shape of Charlotte Harbor means that Cape Coral gets more lightning than Fort Myers because you have some bay breezes and sea breezes. But we are not the lightning capital of the world. This is actually in Venezuela. Lake Maracaibo, they get over 200 days a year with thunderstorms. That's because that lake is surrounded by mountains and the breeze comes up the mountain and lifts the moisture and starts the thunderstorms early. So Florida, over the last 10 years, we've been reducing the number of lightning fatalities, and then last year came and we were back up to our average of 9 fatalities, and the long-term average is 40 injuries a year. So basically, if you can hear thunder, go seek shelter. So we're just gonna leave this statistic up here a little bit. Fatalities by gender. So 4 out of 5 fatalities are men, and then if you're in your 20s, that's the high-risk group. And what are they doing? Well, they're doing outdoor things. So the most at-risk person is a male in his 20s who likes to boat, fish, camp, go to the beach. They're the ones most at risk. It's a myth that the rubber tires of your vehicle protect you from lightning. That's not true. It's the metal shell of your vehicle, it's the metal shell of this aircraft that allows the electricity to flow around you and then finish discharging itself down to the ground. If you were holding on to something metal inside that airplane, you could get burned. All right, there we go. So video cameras can see things about lightning the human eye cannot. This is a step leader coming down. We can't see that typically. And as it gets close enough to the ground, the return stroke is what we see as lightning. So this is a negative lightning strike. It started its formation in the bottom part of the clouds where there are water drops, and that's the negative part of the cloud. Now the positive part of the cloud is in the ice crystals at the top of the cloud. And lightning is reversed. The step leader starts from the ground, goes up to the anvil cloud, and then the positive energy rushes down to the ground. Now, to go 5,000 feet versus 40,000 feet, you need a much bigger lightning discharge to go longer distances. So positive lightning is 3 times stronger than negative lightning. And you can visually tell the difference. If you look at lightning and it's flickering, that's a negative stroke. If you look at lightning and it doesn't flicker, it just goes whoomp, that's a positive stroke. So if you start to see a lot of positive lightning, you're probably gonna hear the fire trucks go out because that's what starts wildfires and house fires. This is the start of a football game in Orlando a few years back. It's a myth that lightning always hits the tallest object. Lightning is lazy. It's gonna find the laziest way to find the ground. And in this case, it happened to be that tree instead of the light tower. Imagine if it would've hit the metal grandstand where all those people are sitting. Now, when the lightning is this close, the flash to the thunder is instantaneous. You get both at the same time. And when that happened, all the football players ran off the field for shelter while all the band members with their big brass instruments kept playing. So, so the NFL and the NCAA have been taking lightning much more seriously. And the Bucks game has been delayed due to lightning the last 3 years in a row. So that's a good thing. So here's a lightning density map. You can see the pink area in downtown Tampa. They get over 15 cloud-to-ground lightning strikes per square kilometer. A square kilometer is about 8 square city blocks. But notice there's a little peak in downtown Cape Coral. So if I decode the statistics for you, on average, lightning strikes something here in your city 4,100 times a year. So that's a lot of lightning. Main reason I'm here today is I want you to call this 800 number anytime you see any of these things and let us know what's going on in your community. Any questions before we move on? All right. We change up the Skywarn training every year. So if you have a picture, send it to me. We'll use it in next year's Skywarn training, and I'll put your name on it. And the other thing is, if you take a picture of a funny-looking cloud and you want to know what it is, just email it, and we can discuss it and try to figure out what you were looking at. So thank you for coming out on this chilly morning to be a volunteer. You're half of our warning program. Radar's a great tool, but it can't beat the human eye on the ground. So we're going to look at just a few terms in safety. Storm strength visual clues. If we have a thunderstorm, which one's stronger than the other one? How does a thunderstorm form, and what makes a supercell different than an ordinary thunderstorm? And then we'll talk about large violent tornadoes, and then we'll end it with hurricanes. So we have watches and warnings. Tornado watch means tornadoes are possible, but we're not certain. Caution, watch the sky. Versus a tornado warning means radar strongly suggests it's there or one of you reported it. If you're in the path of that storm, take cover. A severe thunderstorm warning is defined as 50-knot winds or 1-inch hail or larger. So that's winds near 60 miles an hour. So if we issue a severe thunderstorm warning for Cape Coral, we think one or both of these things are going to happen. To get a thunderstorm, we need fuel, and that's invisible water vapor. We are very dry out there right now. We don't have any fuel. So this invisible water vapor has a lot of energy in it, and we want to release that energy. And we want it to become a visible cloud. And the best way to make invisible water vapor become a visible cloud is to lower its pressure. So we want to lift these bags of air vertically into lower pressure, turn it into a cloud, and then that will make it release a little bit of heat that is starting to pump up this hot air balloon we call a thunderstorm. So we have moisture, we have something to lift the moisture. The final ingredient, we need something called unstable air. It's like blowing oxygen on a fire to get it to burn hot. So let's talk about unstable air. If you hear the TV meteorologist say, hey, we're going to have a front tomorrow and the air is unstable, we're going to have thunderstorms, he or she is talking about the ability for these large vertical towers to develop. So what unstable air means is the temperature inside that cloud is warmer than the temperature outside of that cloud. So it's going to rise like a hot air balloon. Stable, like we have today, you throw up this bag of air 3,000 feet and it falls right back in your hand. Where on the unstable, you throw that bag of air up 3,000 feet, it goes up to 40,000 feet on its own. The best lifting mechanism we have is in the summer. It starts out with the sea breeze front. We're warming up all these bags of air east of here, and they're all going up vertically. Something has to come in to replace the air that's moving vertically, so the cooler, stable air over the marine layer starts to move inland. So you can think of that as a giant pancake sliding inland, and the leading edge of that pancake is that blue line. And it's about 3,000 feet thick. And sometimes that's enough to, it acts like a cold air shovel to scoop up these bags of air and start showers and thunderstorms. What makes Tampa Bay and Charlotte Harbor unique is you get bay breezes in addition to sea breezes. So oftentimes, we'll see the first shower of the day occur in St. Petersburg because the bay breeze is colliding with the sea breeze. If you look at the Tampa airport, the winds are southwest at, say, 6 miles an hour, while the St. Pete airport, just across the bay, winds are northeast at 6 miles an hour. And that's the bay breezes moving inland. The next time you're in a pool, take both your arms on the top of the water and go like this and stop. The result is the two waves that you created are going to collide. And when that happens, you get a rapid vertical motion like this. So colliding boundaries is the best way to start a shower and a thunderstorm. And that's what we're looking for at the Weather Service, is colliding boundaries. So this is a visible satellite image of Central and South Florida. The little white dots are cumulus clouds, maybe towering cumulus clouds. The big white blotches are showers and maybe a thunderstorm. But notice, you can see parts of Cape Coral on here. The skies are clear. That's because the sea breeze front has moved inland, and now you have stable air over the city. But you do have that boundary that could start showers and thunderstorms. Here's the Atlantic Coast sea breeze front. Now, most often in the summertime, the high pressure is centered over Bermuda. Flow around high pressure is clockwise, so we end up with this low-level easterly flow. And that'll take the Atlantic Coast sea breeze front and move it across the state and it collides with our sea breeze front in the afternoon, and then the radar lights up like a Christmas tree. Lake Okeechobee is a pretty big lake. On this day, the cool air over the lake started drifting to the southeast or southwest toward Naples. So when those two boundaries collide, we would look for the potential for thunderstorm development in that region. Once the storms begin, they're going to throw out some cold air. We call that thunderstorm outflow. And if two storm outflows collide, they can start a third storm. So it's all about colliding boundaries that produce the best lift. So here's a thunderstorm off of Clearwater Beach. And there's that arcing blue cloud. Blue is not enough for raindrops, but radar is sensitive. It can detect things that aren't rain. But that's the gust front that's accelerating out ahead of the thunderstorm. And we had winds of about 40 miles an hour at the beach. So if you're standing at the beach and you go, wow, it got windy all of a sudden, but the storms are way offshore, well, this is what happened. And so we're looking for these outflow boundaries, especially when they collide. So to get a thunderstorm to develop, it goes through three stages: the beginning, middle, and end. The towering cumulus. Cumulus is Latin for clump. So you got this towering clump of clouds moving up vertically. It's developing rain and hail aloft, but nothing's falling out of the base. So we can detect it with radar, but nothing's coming out yet because the updraft is holding it all aloft. Now it's going to continue to grow to say 40, 50,000 feet. That rain's going to become too heavy. It's going to start to rain. The minute you see rain coming out of that flat cloud base, that's the mature stage. It's over the next 10 minutes is the best potential for severe weather, if any. But this is a thunderstorm cell. You have at least one updraft, one downdraft. Now, where that downdraft is, you're developing this big pool of cold air underneath the thunderstorm. And that cold air starts to spread out. And it actually undercuts the updraft. And now it blocked any new fuel from reaching the thunderstorm. So the thunderstorm begins to rain itself out, and the cloud bases go up. And now we go into the dissipation stage. And the anvil cloud gets thin and wispy, and the storm's over. So that takes about 30 minutes. But we know storms here last longer than 30 minutes, so what's going on? Well, we have clusters of thunderstorms. Each individual storm in the cluster is at a different stage of the thunderstorm life cycle. So here's a 3D representation of radar of a towering cumulus. You can see that it's being held aloft, all the rain drops. And as it continues with time, the towering cumulus continues to grow. And now we can't see the bottom because the Earth is curving away from the beam, but you see a little bit of red area. That's probably water-coated hail, small hail, and a lot of times it melts before it hits the ground. But now it's raining at the surface. And what happens is it begins to rain itself out. It's almost like a water balloon that descends out of the cloud, and now we go into the dying phase or the dissipation phase, and it just collapses. So the next time a thunderstorm floats over your house, think about this. 1 inch of rain over 1 square mile is 17 million gallons of water. It weighs 145 million pounds. So if the updraft stops for any reason, abruptly, all that water and weight is going to come crashing to the ground. And if it causes damage, we call that a downburst wind. Some people call it straight line winds. So next time a thunderstorm's over your head, think about the millions or billions of pounds of water being held aloft over your head. So this is a non-severe thunderstorm. Winds at the surface are only 30 miles an hour. This is a downdraft because it's not causing damage. And we have a mixture of updrafts and downdrafts in this particular thunderstorm. But sometimes the updraft just stops all at once. And in this case, we call this a microburst. It's a small-scale downburst. And it actually looks like a balloon that's falling out of the bottom of the cloud. It hits the ground, it compresses, the wind accelerates, and blows the rain horizontally away from the downdraft. So the downdraft is the leg, and the rain foot is the rain being blown horizontally away from the downdraft. So if you see a rain foot, that could be damaged in that area, and there's probably going to be more storms with rain foots that day. So when you're looking at rain coming down to the ground, see if you see any indication of a rain foot. So this is a roll cloud. Roll clouds and shelf clouds are very similar. A roll cloud is starting to detach itself from the thunderstorm. It might be lazily rolling horizontally, but it's not a tornado. If this cloud was closer to the thunderstorm base, we would call it a shelf cloud. So the cold air coming down from the rain is acting like a cold air shovel. That's what's causing that cloud to form. This is a shelf cloud. It's a roll cloud, but it's glued to the thunderstorm base. It's lower than the thunderstorm base, and it's caused by that cold air shovel. So the warm heat and humidity is being shoveled up the cold air, and then the rain and cooler air are behind this cloud. So in this picture, the storm is moving left to right across the slide. We're looking to the north, and you can see the warm, humid air and the red arrows being vacuumed up into the storm. If you could see what that cold air looks like, this is a cold air encased in dust in the southwest United States from a thunderstorm. And you can see how big it is. So that's a pretty good cold air shovel. There's a shelf cloud coming off of Lake Okeechobee. So anytime you see a weird horizontally shaped cloud, it's approaching you, there's rain behind it, it's some kind of a shelf cloud, and that means there's either a downdraft or a downburst behind it. So in severe cases, winds can be over 60 miles an hour. Most often, they're 30 to 45 miles an hour. Here's another weird looking shelf cloud southeast of Lakeland and Lake Alfred. The person who took this picture was in the warm, humid air, and when it comes across, just before it reaches you, the winds are gonna switch 180 degrees, your temperature's gonna drop 15, 20 degrees, and in severe cases, the winds will be over 60 miles an hour. So we had a report of a tornado in Sarasota, and we could not find any rotation whatsoever. And they sent us this picture. It sure looks like a tornado, but then we got another picture. It's the same cloud. The first picture, they were looking parallel down the cloud. The second picture, they were looking more perpendicular. And this is a roll cloud that has accelerated ahead of the thunderstorm. So the cold air from the thunderstorm accelerated ahead of the thunderstorm, and it was still producing enough lift to produce that cloud. And that's what happened. So the thunderstorm's way back, and the cold air was racing faster than the thunderstorm was moving. So this is the thunderstorm life cycle. This is a supercell thunderstorm animation, computer-generated animation, and you can kind of see these pulses of blue, cold air, as this storm moves in time. So a supercell thunderstorm forms differently than a normal thunderstorm, and it doesn't go away after 30 minutes. It can last for many hours. So let's say you're in a tornado watch. You look out over the Gulf. You can't see the bottom of the storm, but you can see the top. Look at the top. The thicker, the harder and crisper that anvil cloud is, the stronger the updraft. The stronger the updraft, the bigger the hail, the faster it has to rotate, the better potential for tornadoes. So if we dropped a smoke bomb in this room, the smoke is going to rise, it's going to hit the ceiling, it's going to spread out in all directions. That's the anvil cloud. There should be nothing above the anvil cloud. But we see an overshooting top, that clump of cloud material above the anvil cloud. And what happened there? The updraft was so strong, it punched a hole in the weather-producing atmosphere, the ceiling of the atmosphere, and it went into the stratosphere. So give that storm a lot more respect as it comes into Cape Coral, because it's a strong storm. A lot of times they just kind of pop up right on top of us. So if you're looking at two storms, wondering which one's more likely to have severe weather, look for the one that has a hard, crisp updraft tower with a cauliflower appearance, versus the one on the right looks kind of soft and mushy with a little silver lining. So you'd want to continue to monitor the one on the left and ignore the one on the right. So we have these three ingredients for a garden variety thunderstorm. The missing ingredient for a supercell thunderstorm is called wind shear. Wind shear is changing wind with height. They usually are increasing with height, and they're turning from the south to the west with height. So here's a thunderstorm. Say it's half the size of Lee County. The bottom part of the storm, the winds are south at 35 miles an hour. The top part of the storm, winds are northwest at 90 miles an hour. So this big cylinder in the sky we call a thunderstorm is being pushed at different directions at different levels. And what that does is it separates the updraft and downdraft. So if we pretend that this spigot of water is the thunderstorm updraft, in the summertime in Florida, all the winds aloft are roughly the same. And so the updraft forms vertically, develops rain, it falls through the updraft, kills off the storm, and we're done. We had an El Nino winter last winter. We had a lot of tornadoes down here. And what happened is the winds were increasing with height. So all that rain was being blown downwind. So now that's separated the updraft and downdraft. The updraft gets to get a lot stronger than it should. When do we get violent tornadoes in Florida? March is our peak month for violent tornadoes. Over a 30-year period, we had 30 of them. But we don't get many tornadoes in March. But if we have an El Nino winter, when the jet stream's over Florida, and we have thunderstorms, that's when we get them. So El Nino is the warming of the tropical Pacific waters. That changes where the upper-level jet stream flows. The jet stream is just a meandering superhighway of strong winds, and that steers low-pressure systems at the surface. And last winter, you can see it kind of blew over northern Mexico, right over Florida. On June 21st, 22nd, and 23rd, the Storm Prediction Center put much of the state of Florida in a high risk. They've never done that before. Tampa's never been in a high risk before, ever. And that's because this red area, that's the upper level jet stream, was coming right over Florida. And luckily, nothing happened in our neck of the woods. They had some tornadoes on the other coast. And we're not quite sure why yet, but we definitely had the potential. We tracked a rotating supercell go over Bradenton and over Tarpon Springs, over highly populated areas. And we were very, very nervous, and luckily it didn't corkscrew its way down to the ground. So again, the radar strongly suggested there was something on the ground, but people in the area said, no, there's no damage, nothing happened. Our most deadly tornado is the 1998 Kissimmee outbreak. So we had 42 people killed, 260 people injured. So that's what scares us, is having a tornado come through a highly populated area like this. We had the Groundhog Day tornado of 2007. It was at 3 in the morning. It was on the ground for 17 minutes, and it moved 17 miles. So how fast was it going? It was going at 60 miles an hour at 3 in the morning. Some people woke up outside. The 21 fatalities were all in a manufactured home park. We had two fatalities last year east of Bradenton, and that is their manufactured home. It just rolled. The grandparents perished. The four children, they were babysitting, heard the noise. They ran into a different building nearby, and they survived. Now, there used to be a big barn next to their house as well, and I looked, and I could not find a single piece of debris from that barn, and the barn was gone. And so we looked at radar. We actually detected debris at 10,000 feet above the ground. And so that tornado actually blew that debris into Polk County. So what do people do? I live in a manufactured home. What am I supposed to do? Well, there are things called tornado stairs, where you and your family, you jump in the hatch, shut the hatch, the tornado takes the home, and you're all okay. They're about $5,000 installed, and a lot of people just lease their land. That's kind of a big expense. So now what are you supposed to do? Well, you want to seek shelter before the storms arrive. We only average 12 minutes of heads up a tornado's coming. That's not enough time to seek shelter. So if you're in a tornado watch and you're thinking about going to bed and you see storms out in the Gulf of Mexico, I would stay up. Actually, if I'm in a mobile home, I would probably go to a friend's house. Let's say I just moved here. I don't have any family or friends. Well, maybe I'd go to one of those 24-hour marts, and when the storms come, hide in the bathroom. And when the storms go, pay for my stuff and go back home. Worst possible case, let's say you get caught off guard. Don't stay in a manufactured home. Go into your vehicle and put the car seats all the way down and cover yourself with a blanket. That's not the greatest place to be, but it's better than being inside the home. If you really get into this, we have two online trainings, the Spotter Network and one called MetEd for Meteorological Education. And they're both free. They're both great trainings. And you can really get into the weeds on how some of this stuff works. Any questions on this before we move into the hurricanes? All right. So the 2016 hurricane season was an active year for Florida. We have been having 10 years of very non-active years. So we had in the Atlantic Basin, that's from Brownsville, Texas, to all the way to the African coast, that's 5,000 miles. We had 15 named storms, 7 of them became hurricanes, 3 of those became major hurricanes. And you can see we had 1, 2, 3, 4, almost 5 lines come near the state of Florida. First, it was in June, Tropical Storm Colin. It was a very disorganized, ragged tropical storm, but it still was enough to cause damage. This persistent southwest wind flooded the sponge docks in Tarpon Springs just north of Clearwater. and caused severe beach erosion in Sarasota and Bradenton. This is a boat ramp near Crystal River. And again, this is a very ragged storm well offshore. This is before the storm, and this is during the storm. So the west coast of Florida has a much bigger storm surge problem than the east coast. If you go on the east coast, the land goes up pretty fast. But for us here, that's not the case. Now in Tampa, the 3 foot above normal tides, at high tide when we had heavy rain, the water covered the drainage pipes. So the water had nowhere to go, so the water piles up like this. People are driving across the streets, and we have so many ditches that they're just driving their vehicle into the ditch, and then they're pretty much ruining their vehicle. So even if the water's flooding the road, just wait until the water goes away and then go home. They closed the Sunshine Skyway Bridge because of the strong winds, and we had tree damage all the way up to Jacksonville from Tampa. And when that happens is we had numerous small power outages. So anytime you're in a tropical storm warning, get some LED flashlights and just expect the power is going to go out for a while. Now, Wilma hit in October of 2005, and then we got Hermine hit this year. We went 10 years and 8 months without a hurricane hitting Florida. That's never happened before. Normally, we would have 5 hurricanes strike Florida in that time. So this is a visible satellite loop of Hermine entering the Big Bend area of Florida. And it's a well-developed Category 1 hurricane. This is the radar loop. Oop, let me go back, if I can. I think I need to get a new battery. So look at the size of the eye wall. That was a pretty big eye wall. And that persistent southwest flow, as it hits just north of Crystal River and into Cedar Key, caused storm surge to overtop Cedar Key. And this is what it looked like when it was coming in. It comes in rather fast. And then 911 lit up like a Christmas tree because people wanted to be rescued. And by this time, it's too late. You're stuck. You got to stay. So this is downtown. Water here is maybe 1 to 2 feet deep. At the coast, it was 6 feet above high tide. Ooh, let me go back. So this is the mayor, if I can get this to work. Okay, this is the mayor going down Main Street to survey the damage during a lull in the storm. And so this is saltwater inundation. So they had flooding damage. Right at the coast is where we saw the most significant damage due to the breaking waves. I think I'm going to have to go stand over here. So this used to be a bar, and I asked him, where's the bar? And he says, I don't know. It took out all the tables and chairs, the bar, everything, washed it out into the Gulf, never to be found again. So it's the breaking wave action. The businesses and homes right along the beach are going to have the most damage. This is Yankee Town, half of the town flooded. These poor folks, they're 89 years old. This is the third time their house is flooded since 1985. Drove by this bridge out sign, so I had to check it out. So I went to Google Earth, and this is what that bridge used to look like, and that's what happened after the storm. This is Crystal River. There was 2 feet of water on US 19 in downtown Crystal River. It flooded Kings Bay Marina and all the businesses and homes around there. So for whatever reason, a lot of people did not evacuate for this storm. They said, oh, that skinny black line is staying well north of us. But the impact is well away from that skinny black line. So all the way from Hernando Beach all the way up to Cedar Key, people, when they saw water coming down the streets, so they start calling 911, and they can't do anything for them at that time. If we're going to get a flash flood in Florida, that's typically during a tropical event. This is Largo near St. Petersburg, over 15 inches of rain in 72 hours. With the heavy rain, we have river flooding. Just north of Clearwater, we had 300 homes with over 4 feet of water in them. And then we have overland flooding. And so moving water is dangerous. These are the wind gusts. The 71 mile an hour off of Pinellas County, that's 10 stories up on a high rise, so that's probably overestimated. But the winds, you know, they were at least tropical storm force. And with that, this is what it looked like. This is one of our employees looking at a water fountain outside of his apartment. And winds at this time were about 65 miles an hour where he was. And I was driving to work when this thing hit my car on I-75. And it actually pushed my car sideways about a foot while I was driving. So. Then we had Matthew. Major Hurricane Matthew. It was actually a Category 5 with 160 mile an hour winds south of Haiti. And unfortunately, Haiti took the brunt of the storm surge. So we had a Category 4 just 20 miles off of the Florida coast. That is something scary. We happened to notice the next generation of hurricane hunters was in this storm. We used Flight Track Aware, and this is NASA, and they repurposed a drone to go into the storm and drop instruments. So the Air Force will still be flying these, but there won't be any people in the plane. And so that's the future. Now the research hurricane hunters, which are part of NOAA, they moved to Lakeland this year, and they will always be around because we're always doing research.
All of you.
Start that one over. We get a lot of hype with storms. And if you know this gentleman,
Daytona Beach, all the way up to Jacksonville, this moves 20 miles to the west, and you and everyone you know are dead. All of you. Because you can't survive it. It's not possible unless you're very, very lucky. And your kids die too.
Yeah, so that's. But he had a point, because the European model, which traditionally had been doing better than the US model, had the eye wall completely onshore going up through Orlando. And the U.S. model had it kind of where the track actually went. And we got lucky that it was actually offshore, because we would have had billions and billions of dollars worth of damage if it would have been onshore. This is Haiti, over 1,000 people killed. And after the storm, you know, hundreds of thousands of survivors were at risk of starvation in Cloria. This is before the storm surge, and that's after the storm surge. 1 cubic yard of water weighs 1,700 pounds. So if you had a fish tank that's 3 feet by 3 feet by 3 feet, and that fish tank was filled with salt water and was moving at you at 20 miles an hour and you tried to stop it, what's gonna happen? Now imagine you got millions of these fish tanks pushing on a house, what's gonna happen? Before Katrina storm surge in Waveland, Mississippi, these people have their shutters below their windows. They put on their shutters and they evacuated. Some of their neighbors did not. Keep an eye on the big oak tree. This is before the storm surge, and that's after the storm surge. So if you get water that's sufficient in depth and it's moving, this is the incredible type of damage we can see. So Matthew, we had 12 fatalities in Florida, and most of them were after the storm, people cleaning up the debris. And carbon monoxide poisoning, people walking into water where there's a downed power line. So it's dangerous during the storm. It can be more dangerous after the storm. Be very, very careful. It caused severe beach erosion, took parts of A1A and put it into the Atlantic at Flagler Beach, swamped boats. This is St. Augustine. It overtopped parts of the island. And it's something I did not know, that if half your home is damaged, then you have to rebuild it up to current code. But it's not how much you paid for the house. It's your tax evaluation, which is a lot less in most cases. So it's really easy. They had a bunch of homes that where that happened, and those people are not happy. We have a new inlet. In fact, as you're driving along the Barrier Islands and you go over a little bridge, those inlets were probably caused by some past hurricane storm surge. What's more interesting than this inlet south of St. Augustine is that one. It went right under this person's house. And the stilts were the only thing holding up this house. And I talked to the emergency manager and says, yeah, it's gonna cost that person $300,000 to put the sand back. So this guy survived. And he ran into this after the water had receded. If the water was still flowing through there, he would have been dragged downstream. And it was dark out, he couldn't see that the road was washed out. So let's say it's been raining like crazy and it's heavy rain out there and you want to evacuate to Arcadia in the middle of the night. I would not drive in heavy rain because you don't know if the road is washed out or not. And sometimes the weight of your vehicle will actually initiate the washout. Had a shark in front of somebody's front porch. But this was photoshopped. Unfortunately, we get a lot of people that try to trick the TV meteorologist into showing their stuff on TV, and so that's something we're always on the lookout for. We'll end it with evacuations. People are evacuated because they live in the storm surge zone or a manufactured home. We tell people to go tens of miles, not hundreds of miles. During Hurricane Charley, I was actually in the Fort Myers Emergency Operations Center. And my wife's by herself up in Tampa, and that skinny black line's going to Tampa. The TV meteorologists are scaring her. She's calling me every 5 minutes. What do I do? What do I do? I said, go to South Lake and to your mom's house. You'll be fine. So I sent her into the path of the hurricane. She has a lot of new jewelry. Yes. Yes. So people that live in a storm surge zone. Most of this area is in some kind of evacuation zone, so it's important to know which zone you're in. And for people that live in manufactured homes, even if you're in Arcadia, they're going to be asked to evacuate. Now, the five most difficult hurricane evacuation areas in the country. Number five is the Miami area. I thought they would have been higher on the list. Number four and number three we saw in Hurricane Sandy, New York, New Jersey coast, and the Delmarva Peninsula. Who do you think number two is? Tampa Bay. Who do you think number one is? It's you guys. You have too many people and not enough roads. So if the 1926 Miami hurricane was to happen again, all three of those areas would be evacuated. So if you ever see a forecast where that line does something like this, go to the store early and get your bread and your peanut butter, because the stores are going to be wiped clean with people evacuating. Now we have something you can do. We are looking for somebody within your organizations, whether it's an HOA, a church, where you work, to be an ambassador for us. And what an ambassador does is they get on a special email list, and we send preparedness information once or twice a month, and then you share it with the people you know, and sociologists have told us that they're more likely to do it if they get it from somebody they know. So here's a couple of examples. We have like a simple two-page emergency plan. Ask them to fill it out, share a copy with somebody up north, and you're good. We have infographics that we create that you can post on your social media websites or your newsletters in your HOA. So these are just a few. We are up to about 120 in West Central and Southwest Florida. If you want to be an ambassador, the link is on one of your handouts, and you can fill it out there. Or you can come up and fill this out, and I'll enter the information for you and get you signed up. So with that, does anybody have any questions for me?
If you could talk a little bit about last year after the tornado in Cape Coral and how the National Weather Service helped supported us as a jurisdiction, as well as what happened afterwards and how you came out to do the determinations for the storm.
Yeah, so that tornado, I had one story from, I don't know if any of you know Bill Van Helden, used to be the fire chief here. He was in, I think, Chili's or Applebee's, and he said everybody's phone went off at once. And so that's how he knew that something bad was going on, and he got everybody away from the windows. But that tornado, we came down, and we can plot block by block the damage. So it helps the community with the impact of that tornado, as well as which building codes worked, which didn't. So I wasn't the one that did that survey. Did you have anything specific, Jesse, that you wanted to say?
If you can talk about how you go into communities, the National Weather Service, to determine the length and the width and the severity of tornadoes when they go through communities.
Yeah, so we do, you know, those damage surveys. We just did that one in Mansota Key and up by Cleveland in Punta Gorda to not only document the storm, but to see how wide was it. How long was the path? Was it a continuous path, or did it jump up and down? And we use that to improve our warning services and to document what happened in the storm. It all goes in a national publication called Storm Data. That's free for anybody. And it can be used to prove that, hey, I had damage at my house, if the insurance adjuster is trying to say, oh, no, you didn't. So it's something that we do work closely with emergency management. They're our number one partner. Not only for, you know, to plan, prepare, and respond to the storms, but we also work after the storms to document.
I have a question.
Yes.
So this was the second time we had a tornado take that same path.
So he said it's the same path that they've had before with a tornado. Some of that might be due to Charlotte Harbor. There's less friction over the water, and the winds pile up like cars going into a tail, you know, into a toll booth. So I suspect the land has something to do with that, the path. So does the high rises make a funnel? I think they're so small compared to the size of the tornado. I don't know if it has that much influence, but the Charlotte Harbor is a very big compared to the size of the tornado. And speaking about high rises, the one that hit Siesta Key last January hit a 10-story condominium, blew out every window on every side of the entire building, and on the front side, it blew out the walls on the inside as well. And I talked to the people, and there were no injuries. They said they got that wireless emergency alert on their phone. And I asked them where they're from, because they had an accent. They said they were from Europe. So I didn't realize that their phones would work as well. I don't know if it's the SIM card or what, but they got the alert and went into the bathroom, and they were fine. So, yes, sir.
I think I understand the limitations of your radar, where it's located in the horizon and everything like that. Well, our three over-the-air broadcasts real Doppler, almost real Doppler, and who's looking at our Doppler because nobody else is, because it's not real. Should we expect a little better coverage from those local things, even we might get from our weather radio?
Well, radar is just a tool, and we are on a secure chat server with the local media, and we're sharing reports, and especially with water spouts, because we're not going to detect a water spout down here. They might say, hey, I think I see a water spout off shore. We may or may not issue the warning based on that. The radar coverage isn't bad. It's the first 20 miles of radar coverage is hard to use. So 20 to 60 miles away from the radar is the best radar data you can get.
Clutter, they talk about ground clutter.
Yeah, you get a lot of ground clutter. It gets tough to see signatures sometimes. Sometimes the beam just gets all messed up when it's that close. So the Florida Division of Emergency Management, the Department of Transportation, Florida Department of Law Enforcement, I think they've all come to the conclusion that this will not work, because you would have to have a law enforcement person at every exit. So I think what they're looking at now is actually using those where you pull off the road when your car gets wrecked, those little patches of tar, are using those for lanes as well. Because that reversible highway stuff, I can't imagine it working too well.
Yeah,
all right.
I'll add to that real quick as well.
Yep.
We just had a regional evacuation exercise in Lee County last week. And the purpose of that was to identify how to get, as Dan mentioned, that we are very vulnerable if we do have to evacuate within the region. And the region is a 10-county region, okay? And you have to move several hundred thousands of people out on some very short, narrow roadways out of the area. So the reverse laning or contraflow traffic that's been used in other jurisdictions across the United States or attempted in other jurisdictions, that may not work here in the state of Florida in certain areas. And it has been determined by those entities that Dan talked about that that's not going to work for us. So the next method to utilize is what's known as hard shouldering. So you basically, during an evacuation, your traffic is going very slow anyway, right? So they can utilize the hard shoulders, which is either the right or left side of the road, which you'd pull your car over if your car is broke down, and use that because traffic's only going to be going at 20 to 30 miles an hour at that point anyway. So they are going to be working on messaging moving forward to be able to identify to citizens that if an evacuation order is given, they may activate hard shouldering for evacuation and signage, and personnel will be out there to direct you to the hard shoulder, which is basically taking a two-lane road, making it a three-lane road with that hard shoulder. So those are one of the avenues moving forward.
So, not a lot of great options. If you want a spotter ID number emailed to you next week, be sure to leave this sheet up here on the front desk. And otherwise, thank you all for coming out today. I appreciate you volunteering your time. Take care.